sings the Father's song. He calls the Son to wake the dawn and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson gray. His fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning gold. He charts the eagle's fly, commands the newborn baby's cry.
Glory. mighty. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail. Let the truth prevail, overrun belief. And by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
Good morning. Welcome to church this morning. It's Palm Sunday, and we're at the start of Holy Week. Now, we think our life has lots of ups and downs, but for Jesus, this week was certainly marked with ups and downs. Today, he was riding into Jerusalem, and everybody was celebrating how wonderful he was. By Thursday, he was being betrayed. By Friday, he was being crucified. And of course, on Sunday, he was risen again. So when people say, well, the church really doesn't have any relevance to our everyday lives, it may well be that your ups and downs aren't anything like as dramatic as that, but they certainly, you do have ups and downs. And so we have a Lord that we can go to and tell him about what's going on in our life. But more than that, we can worship him. We can come and sing his praise. We can come and listen to his word, both spoken and preached. And we can pray to him. So as we start this service, let's do that, shall we? Lord, we're thankful that you are someone who really understands us, that we can come to you, we can open our hearts to you, and we can go away satisfied that we have met you and strengthened in our Christian life. And this we ask in your name. Amen. Our opening hymn. Rejoice the Lord.
Again. shall to his command and fall beneath his feet.
Lift up your heart, lift up your voice, rejoice again, I say, rejoice.
Saying sorry to God. Before we start, just let's have a moment. We know what we're going to say, and we say it in most weeks. And in the busyness of life, we can sometimes forget the importance of this. We know in our own relationships, that when something has happened, until we say sorry to the other person, that relationship is strained. And that's equally true with our relationship with God. So this is an opportunity to clear the air and help us to move on in our Christian lives. We are not always gentle, kind, humble, meek, and patient as you want us to be. Father, in your mercy,
please.
We say, think, and do things which hurt others and hurt you. Father, in your mercy,
please.
We find it difficult to put up with and forgive others. Father, in your mercy,
please forgive us.
We don't include you in all that we do. Father, in your mercy,
please forgive us.
So these are powerful words, not words that are coming from me. I'm just saying the words. But at the back of those words, what God has done for us. May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring us his pardon and peace, now and forever.
Amen.
So we stand and we declare our faith. Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, Jesus Christ, who took human nature, died for us, and rose again?
We believe and trust in him.
And do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world?
We believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith.
We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks, John. Do take a seat. Fantastic to see you all here. Not long now till Easter. Easter week. My name's Chris. If you don't already know me, I'm a vicar here and at Church of the Saviour. Just a couple of things coming up. Community Cafe carries on every Thursday, 2 till 4, Church of the Saviour. You can skip that one. Easter week. So this week, we're keeping busy. We're having an evening communion here on Maundy Thursday, as we remember Jesus in the garden, the Last Supper. And then on Good Friday, meet here at 10 o'clock in the morning. Be prepared for a walk. Pray for sunshine. And we'll walk across the valley to Church of the Saviour. We'll have a brew. Apparently there's hot cross buns. And then there'll be a service at 11 a.m. there. If you don't fancy a walk, you can just come straight to the service at 11 a.m. We'll turn up 15 minutes early for a hot cross bun at Church of the Saviour. And then Easter Sunday, all our services as usual, as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. After our service on Sunday morning, next week, Easter Sunday, what do you think we're going to have, children? Yeah? Isabel? An egg hunt. So there'll be an Easter egg hunt, just for children, adults, sorry, after the service, and next week on Easter Sunday. Skip that. We're planning to have a big celebration, sort of worship, and then food and activities on the field for the Jubilee celebration. We're going to do it on the 12th of June in partnership with the school, and hopefully invite our community as well. If that's something that you'd like to be involved in helping organise, come and see me. We'd love a couple of more people to come and help us organise that. We're going to have a service for all our congregations at 10:30 that morning. So that will be the one service for the whole benefice on that day. So do come and join us, but also if you'd like to help plan, come and talk to me. Now, the Church of England has got this thing. It's the closest the Church of England has got to a church membership. It's called the electoral roll. And if you're a member of the if you're on the electoral roll, it means you can vote in our yearly meeting, which is coming up after Easter. And it's also you saying, I'm part of this church community. In order to be on the electoral roll, you need to have been coming to church for 6 months, or live in the parish. And you need to fill in a form. So if that's something you want to do, don't see me because I'm useless with paperwork. See Sheila. Sheila, do you want to stand up? Sheila organises me. So if that's something you'd like to do, go and talk to Sheila. Do join us at our evening service every Sunday at 7 o'clock in the evening. It's also live streamed and on YouTube if you want to catch up on that. If you want your attendance registered, do sign in the foyer legibly so that we can know you're here for things like school entry. We love to give. God's a great giver, and we love to give back to him. There's ways to do that in the foyer, card machine, and the box there. But let's give thanks for all we're able to give back to God. Let's pray. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. We're going to sing our all-age song now, after which our Sunday school crash will head out the back. So let's stand and sing together.
You
Sheila's quietly smiling. We turn now to Psalm 23, page 555, and we're going to say it together. This is a psalm that's given people comfort all down the ages. And so as we say it, let's give thanks to God for that comfort it's given other people and given to us. We say together, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of the Lord. And now we have our New Testament reading from Mark's Gospel.
So we're reading from Mark 14, beginning at verse 1, and you will find that on page 1020 in the church Bibles. Mark 14, verse 1. Page 1020. Now the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for some sly way to arrest Jesus and kill him. But not during the feast, they said, or the people may riot. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of a man known as Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her harshly. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you will always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want. But you will not always have me. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. I tell you the truth, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her." Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted to hear this and promised to give him money. So he watched for an opportunity to hand him over. This is the word of the Lord.
Do keep that open as we have a look at that Bible passage together. I'll go on to this for you guys. Something to think of as we start. Have a think of what's the most precious thing you own? Your heart. And then what would make you give it up? Let's pray. Lord, as we come to this passage together, as we think about how this lady was willing to devote herself and give her all for Jesus, we pray you would inspire us to do the same. In Jesus' name, amen. I brought a couple of things with me today. Been raiding the cupboards at home. You wanna know what this is? Anyone been using any of this recently? They're all coming up, aren't they? And then I've got some... Now this is starting to get more precious, isn't it? Because well, there's like 9% of the sunflower oil comes from Ukraine and Russia or something. So I've got some oil with me. What's this? Some very special items.
Almost oil. More expensive than almost oil. Is it type of oil?
Got tea tree. Anyone want a sniff?
What was that? No, you put it more to me, just.
Is it that?
No. This is frankincense oil. Almost expensive oils.
There you go. Now, of these three, which would you give to an enemy? Which would you give to someone you loved a lot and were devoted to? Good friends and sense. And if you thought someone's all right, might give them a bit of oil. You know, in the Old Testament, used to anoint people's head with oil, didn't they? Okay. Now, in this passage, we see... This isn't just random real. There's three groups of people, and we see how these three groups respond to Jesus. And the first group I want us to look at are the weed killer group. Yeah? They want to kill Jesus. We see them at the start and at the end of this Bible passage. So have a look at verse 1 of Mark 12. Mark 14. Going all the way back to the triumphal entry, otherwise. Chapter 14, verse 1. The Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for some sly way to arrest Jesus and kill him. So the Passover's approaching, and Mark has been counting us down to the Passover period, the time when the Passover lamb was sacrificed. And Jerusalem would have been starting to fill up with worshippers. And there'd be lots of Jews coming from all over, God-fearers, coming for the Passover feast, the Passover festival. And at the Passover festival, what they were really celebrating was God rescuing his people from Egypt. But as they're doing that, the religious leaders are plotting to kill God's king, aren't they? They're looking for a sly way to arrest Jesus and kill him. But not during the feast, they say, or the people may riot. These religious leaders, they want Jesus dead. And over the past couple of weeks, we've been seeing why. That Jesus has been telling them that they are failed leaders, that their system of religion, including the temple worship, had failed. They weren't worshipping God properly, and they weren't being a light to the nations. And they've been trying to trick Jesus to get him in trouble. Remember all those things about, you know, if someone's married seven times, which one do they get to be married to when in the resurrection? And should we pay taxes to Caesar or not? And they tried to trick him to get him in trouble so he'd get arrested and killed, but they'd failed. But look what happens. Just have a look at verse 10. But then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priest to betray Jesus to them. And they were delighted to hear this and promised to give him money. So he watched for an opportunity to hand him over. There's a traitor amongst Jesus' followers, willing to betray Jesus for money. To hand over Jesus for the promise of wealth. The religious leaders, they want Jesus dead. Judas Iscariot is willing to pay to betray Jesus. But then we see in verse 3, a very different reaction to Jesus, don't we? We see the, you might call it the frankincense reaction to Jesus. Although it wasn't frankincense to use, it was something even more expensive. So Jesus is at this feast in Bethany. He's on his way to Jerusalem, in Bethany, and a woman comes in. And we're not told here who this woman is, but in John's gospel, she's identified as Mary. Not Mary, the mother of Jesus, a different Mary. And she's got a jar of something that's more expensive than frankincense. It's an alabaster jar, which is the kind of jar you seal the best perfume in. And actually, we find out later that this is perfume is worth a year's wages. Now, I Googled the average wage in the UK, and it's £26,000 a year. It's a lot of money, isn't it? So here's a jar of perfume worth the equivalent of a year's wage, £26,000. I mean, imagine having a jar of something worth that much. But the lady isn't actually thinking about the worth of the oil. She's focused on the worth of Jesus. And so she takes this jar and she cracks it open. There's no going back once you crack one of those jars open. And she pours it on Jesus. She anoints his head. It's a way of saying that this person is special and important and worthy of everything I have. In the Old Testament, that anointing has connotations of kingship, being anointed with oil, but also being special to God. We read about it in Psalm 23, didn't we? Anoint my head with oil. See, this woman is showing that Jesus is precious to her. And so she takes what's most precious in terms of expense and gives it over to Jesus. What a beautiful thing to do. But actually, the disciples don't think so, do they? You'd think the disciples would know better. They've been with Jesus all the time. They don't want Jesus dead. They're his friends. They love him. But they don't quite think he's worth all that the lady's done there. They're more of the oil givers than the frankincense givers. And so they actually have a go at this woman, don't they? So verse 4, some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, why this wasted perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages and given to the poor. And they rebuked her harshly. It's interesting, isn't it, how those disciples don't quite think that Jesus is worth all that. They know he's special, but they don't think him worthy of all you have. And I wonder how often we're like the disciples, aren't we, if we're honest? We don't want to get rid of Jesus. We don't want him dead. We love him. We follow him. But we're not quite sure he's worth our all. We're not quite sure we want to give everything to him. We often think there's better uses, perhaps, I guess, of our time and our money than worship of Jesus. And that's, I guess, why we struggle to make it to church every week or to give sacrificially or to meditate on Jesus daily or to push ourselves to obey him more and more. Because in our heart, really, we don't always realize how worthy and special Jesus is. And we're so easily distracted by other things. We think Jesus is all right, but we don't think he's number one. That's where the disciples are. But Jesus responds to the disciples by saying, no, what this woman does is amazing. It is right. He holds her up as a model disciple. And we're told four things about what this woman has done. The first we see in verse 6. Have a look at verse 6. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me." I wonder how you measure beauty. Maybe it's on how perfect someone's face looks. Maybe beauty is measured in how many likes you get on your Facebook posts or anything like that. Maybe you think beauty is about social status or about wealth or popularity. Jesus says true beauty involves giving ourselves to him. True beauty is about how we relate to him. If you've ever read Proverbs, at the end of Proverbs, there's a chapter where wisdom is described as a woman, a wife of noble character. And listen to Proverbs chapter 31, verse 30. It says this: "Charm is deceptive and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised." Fear of the Lord, the dedication to Jesus, that is the most beautiful thing we can look for in a person. Then secondly, verse 8, she did what she could. Isn't that great? You might think, I've got an alabaster jar of perfume. Jesus isn't asking you to give him some perfume. He commends her because she did what she could. It's likely she wasn't actually a rich lady. That's not why she had this perfume. It's likely, from what we learn of her in the rest of the Bible, that she was probably not particularly wealthy, but this was a family heirloom, something that had been passed down from generation to generation. When I asked my wife to marry her, I thought, I'm not buying an engagement ring, they're well expensive. But there's a family heirloom, and it had platinum, three diamonds in. I thought, that'll do. Passed down through generation. I don't know if you've got something like that in your family, it's a watch or a ring or something like that. But this woman, you can just imagine her, you know, thinking, oh, I want to show how much I love Jesus. What can I give him? I've not got much. Is that family heirloom, that perfume, that precious ointment? I'll use that. I'll give that to Jesus. And it's interesting, isn't it? It's not just, she doesn't just leave it at his door and sort of run away, does she? Her giving is relational. There's something very personal, even intimate, about coming up to someone and pouring oil on their head. It's a relational giving. For you are going to think, what do I have? What can I use it for Jesus? It comes out of our relationship with him, doesn't it? And in service of him. She's done a beautiful thing. She did what she could. And then verse 9. "I tell you the truth, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her." Jesus says she's going to be remembered. Does anyone here remember their great grandparents? Yeah? Great great grandparents? Great 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 grandparents? Does anyone remember anyone in their family 500 years ago? We forget, don't we? I am under no illusions. In 1,000 years' time, no one will know who Chris Anderson is. I said this at Friday Live, and someone, one of the kids, goes, "Is Chris Anderson a real person?" It's me. That's me. No one's going to know who I am. Probably no one's going to know I'm in 100 years. And that's fine. But here we get this in Mars, the unnamed lady who lived about 2,000 years ago, and we're still reading about her. Every year in most churches, because they do the liturgy, she's read about in every church in the entire world. Her story is in the most popular, most printed book in all time, the Bible. Why? You know, Jesus always blesses when we're generous to him, doesn't he? When we're generous, you know, I've never regretted being generous for Jesus. It's hard at the time sometimes. But you never regret it because Jesus blesses it. Look how he's blessed this woman 2,000 years later. And I wonder why Jesus wants her to be remembered. Yes, to bless her. But also because I think he wants to hold her up and say, be like her. She's a model for you. Aim to be devoted as she is. So I wonder what it would look like for us to have that kind of devotion to Jesus. What would we change in our lives to show that kind of devotion? I imagine it would affect our diaries, the way we planned our time, or bank accounts, the way we spent our money. Devotion to Jesus, it changes the way you do family life. It changes your retirement plans. It might change the next house you buy, or the job you do, or how many days work you do in your job. It's beautiful to serve Jesus. What can we do to be devoted to him, like this lady? Well, there's one last thing that Jesus says about this woman. We see it in verse 8. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. That's a slightly odd thing to say, isn't it? Jesus says she's preparing me for my death. And there's an interesting contrast. Judas is preparing to get Jesus killed for the sake of money. This woman is giving all she has, unknowingly pointing towards the death that Jesus is going to go to willingly for us. She's anointing a dead man, or a soon-to-be dead man, even though she doesn't really know it at this time. And this is why Mark counts us down towards the Passover feast. Because as Jesus heads to the Passover, he's heading to his death. He is the Passover lamb that is sacrificed for the sins of his people. And there's also a hint here of what kind of death he's going to have. Because normally if you died in the Jewish tradition, you would be anointed with oil and put in a tomb. But if you died as a criminal, you wouldn't be anointed. You'd be buried straight away. And Jesus wasn't anointed, was he, straight after he died? But in a way, this woman is anointing him ready for his death as a criminal on the cross. This week's Easter week, we go through Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, Easter Sunday. And so this week, take some time reflecting on why Jesus is so special. Take some time reflecting on why he's so worth our devotion. Take some time reflecting on the fact that he willingly went to the cross to die for our sins, to forgive us our sins, and to bring us into his kingdom. He is the Passover lamb who frees us from slavery to sin. And I guess it's as we have a deeper sense of what Jesus has done for us that we'll be more and more devoted to him. Let's pray. Lord, as we reflect on the attitudes of this woman, we confess that so often we lack devotion to you. We surrender some, but not all. Lord, thank you so much that you surrendered all for us, that Jesus was willing to give his life, his precious blood on the cross, that he is so devoted to us. And as we reflect on that this week, would we see how worthy he is of our full devotion? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And we're going to sing now of a song that picks up on that theme. So let's stand and sing.
Let's pray. Holy God, on this Palm Sunday, we pray for all our church leaders, clergy and lay ministers as they prepare for Holy Week and Easter. We ask that your blessing be with them, with their spirit, and that your spirit will guide them. Inspire them as they lead these services of your Holy Week and Easter. May those who confess your name be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal the glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that your gift of your Lord's Supper. Thank you that we are called to remember the price that Jesus paid for our sin and for our communal remembrance at the communion table. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, we're continually amazed at how you turn this world upside down. For a saviour of the world, we would have chosen a powerful prince, but you chose a carpenter's son, born under questionable circumstances. For disciples to help Jesus through his ministry, we would have chosen well-connected, wealthy people of upper class to bankroll the operation. But you chose fishermen, a tax collector, and such outcasts. For a grand entrance into Jerusalem, we'd have chosen a white stallion, but you chose a donkey. When riding high in the poles on Palm Sunday, we'd have chosen to stay there as long as we could, but you chose to clear the temple. For a place of coronation, we'd have chosen a palace with a wonderful decorated royal throne, but you chose a cross. For those who we want to have included in the kingdom of God, we'd have chosen those who look something like we do, but you chose the whole world. For people to show the love and grace extended to us in Jesus Christ, we'd have chosen somebody else. But today, Lord, you chose each of us. Use us today. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Father, we pray for the peacemakers, talented men and women of the world who work through your world finding ways for enemies to talk to each other, to seek common ground, to compromise, and eventually to reconcile their differences. Grant them patience and understanding and the knowledge that their work may bring peace. We pray especially for those who are working for peace in Ukraine today. Lord, in your mercy. We think about those people we know who are poorly, who are sick, who are ill, who need your loving, tender care wrapped around them. We pray especially for the vulnerable people. And we think about those people close to us and members of our congregation. We pray for Annette, Yvonne, Nan, for George and Paul, for Lorraine and Joan, for Tony, for Keith, for Sandra and Daniel, for Val and Laura, for Claire, Elizabeth, Peter, Keith, Joe, Megan, Phil, and Mike and family. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your eternal salvation. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, during this coming Holy Week, help us to prepare, to remember, and to contemplate on all that happened in that first Holy Week many thousands of years ago. The Passover meal you shared, your betrayal, the sacrifice of Good Friday, and the joy of Easter Sunday. Amen.
Your peace and quiet is about to be shattered. Do you want to get everyone back in?
Excellent. Come in. Hello, Finley. Hello, Ezra. Finley, are you going to come and show us what you've been doing? Yeah. Let's wait for it. Isabel's here as well. Oh, he's got a box. Just you two.
There was only three of us.
There was three of you. Okay. So it's you and Isabel, and who else are we waiting for? Lucy. Right. Wait a minute. Finley, do you want to say anything? Fantastic. Hold it up.
It's better than that we compare the happy sad together and sleeping.
So you've got these faces, these silly faces. She got devil horns on that person. When you're mad. Lucy, do you want to say anything? Do you want to hold it up and show everyone what you've been making with your googly eyes? Fantastic. Give them a clap. Isn't that great? Okay. To share the Lord's Supper now as we reflect on what Jesus has done for us on the cross. So let's say his words. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right in thanks and praise.
Right to praise you, God, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turn away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son.
We're gracious as your children, and welcome us to sit and
meet with you. In Christ you shared your life, that we might live in him, and he in us.
Your mind is out to work for us, and made for all the perfect sacrifice of sin.
The night he was betrayed, supped with his friends, and took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.
Father, do this in remembrance of him. His body is great.
At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave thanks and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me.
Father,
to proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ.
As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ.
The whole church around the world, we offer you this, our sacrifice. Our praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven, saying,
holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
So as our Savior taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. On earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of Jesus, now and forever. Amen.
Pray this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I'll share among us. So in a moment, if you'd like to put down a set trial or at the table at the back as well, set up your hands, and then if you confirm that the Lord of the Church, trusting Jesus and following him, take communion, I'll dip the bread on the line with your hands. If you prefer a prayer, follow the arms, the prayer of blessing, if you prefer to sit in the seat, you're welcome to do that. Do bring children up to be prayed for as well. I'll be at the back. Duncan, are you happy? Are you ready for that? Fantastic. And so draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith with that faith.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. And so we share in this bread. Savior Jesus Christ torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. Table of the King.
It's a joy to celebrate the Lord's Supper together, isn't it? And to reflect on all Jesus has done for us. So let's pray, committing ourselves to God's service. Together we say, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and to work to your praise and glory. We're going to sing our final hymn now, and then there's a time for refreshments afterwards. Do stick around for refreshments if you're able to. And can I encourage you to talk to someone who you wouldn't normally talk to? Be brave. There's something you don't know. There's some plants in the foyer that Jeff's brought that he's trying to get rid of. So feel free to take them. If you want to make a donation, you can. Or just take them. And during this last hymn, children, I need your help, because we need to hand these palm crosses out to everyone. So during the hymn, wait a minute, Isabel. During the hymn, if you come out, grab a cross and hand them out. So let's stand and sing our final hymn.
Prostrate fall, bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Lord of all.
As we stand, thank you, Jesus, that you are Lord of all, and yet you chose to go to the cross to die and save us. Lord, we want to magnify you and give you all the praise you deserve, as we reflect on all you've done for us this Easter. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's say the grace to each other. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all forevermore. Amen.
Eyes are fire, his face is light, the first and last, the living one, his name is Jesus. And from his mouth there comes a sound that shakes the earth and splits the ground. And yet this voice is life to me, the voice of Jesus. And I will sing songs of love, calling out across the earth. The King has come, the King of love has come. And troubled minds can know his peace, captive hearts can be released. The King has come, the King of love has come. My lover's breath, his wine, I am his prize and he is mine. How can a sinner know such joy because of Jesus? The wounds of love are in his hands, the price is paid for sinful man. Accepted child, forgiven son, because of Jesus. And I will sing my songs of love, calling out across the earth. The King has come, the King of love has come. In troubled minds can know his peace, captive hearts can be released. The King has come, the King of love has come. Such love, before such grace, I will let the walls come down. Lord, you know that you are welcome here. Before such love, before such grace, I will let the walls come down. I will let the walls come down. And I will sing my songs of love, calling out across the earth. The King has come, the King of
we like Jesus' mission failed. But his sacrifice accomplished victory over sin.